people.
Okay, we're getting off track. But yeah, I mean,
and that's what they want you to do. Sorry, I'm finished.
I'm coming to our program.
That's a good one.
What's going on, world? Welcome to episode 92 of the Rams Like Diamonds podcast. Three boys, Peter.
Peace.
Mohammed.
Yeah.
Myself, Yemi. Just the three of us this week. Boys, how we doing today?
Blessed, bro. What are you saying?
Good. Very good. Very good to be here. What are you, Mohammed?
Chilling. God is good all the time.
All the time. All the time. God is good.
God is good.
Let's get this cracking.
100%. 100%. Drakes is here also.
Big up, Drakes.
Big up, Drakes. How's it going, bro?
Good, man. How are you?
Lovely.
You enjoy Fast and Furious yesterday?
Calm, calm, calm. Did you enjoy Fast and Furious yesterday?
Before Light edit the shit out of this.
Why?
So, I could talk about what I've been up to. I went to see Cleo Soul.
Oh yeah. Finally.
How the long Cleo awaited.
The long awaited.
Yeah, bro.
How was it?
Royal Albert Hall and that, bro. So we walked in, man. And I'd never been there before.
Oh, he's giving us the blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. I'd never been there before, man. So I didn't really know what to expect or whatever, innit? But then, like, big up Case. Like, she was like, yo, this is a big deal, man. So I was like, all right, cool, bet. Get in there, yeah. And it was wham, bro. You had this, like, massive, like, disco ball coming down the ceiling and that. And then you had, like, Bev, like, you had a band and that. Had some massive organ and that. It was sick. And then, yeah, she came out, bro. The lights went off. She came out, bro. And she just looked glorious, man. Right, so and Janet,
bro.
And yeah, bro, it was just an amazing performance, man. It was one of the best vocal performances I've been to before. Like, I didn't really have expectations, but I didn't think she'd sound like the albums though. And she did, bro. She did like the majority of Rose in the Dark, it was a 2-hour show, which I didn't expect. She did the majority of Rose in the Dark, and then she did the Mother album, and yeah, man, she just smacked it, man. She brought out Chronics and Michael Kiwanuka, and I thought she might bring out Sims. I was like, oh, she's gonna bring out Sims, but that didn't happen. Overall, it was an amazing, amazing show, man. So I recommend anyone, if they get a chance, to go see Cleo Soul, man. It's crazy.
Salute to Cleo Soul.
People, Peter's whole life has been leading up to this. At least pod life, anyway. You may have noticed every episode he shouts out this woman, Cleo Soul.
I manifested it.
He manifested seeing her live in the biggest possible stage at the Royal Albert Hall, and your boy achieved his dreams.
Salute to
Cleo Soul.
Hey, man.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Now, back to reality. what were you up to this week, Mo?
Chilling, man. Just work. Football. Work. Nothing more, nothing. Last game of the season last week. Nothing more.
No social activities,
nothing, man. I live a boring life, you know. Man, like, I wish my life was more intense. I wish I could tell you guys, I'm not like this guy, fan guy, Fast and Furious. How about you, Yemi? How are you?
My week's been fine. Yeah, it's just been work. I've been living vicariously through everybody that's been at Recess Land and DLT Motor. If you don't know what that is, Recess Land is like a kind of carnival organized by Recess, is like a black nightlife collective. They did that in Margate, Kent, and then DLT Motor. It's kind of like the same thing, but they're doing a festival in Malta and all the blacks are there except for us. So yeah, just been looking at Twitter and being very jealous.
That's what DLT.
Speaking of blacks, there was a lot of black people at Cleo Soul actually, but there was a lot of white people there too. I was actually surprised by that because I think, remember we had the episode where we were talking about like audiences and that, and who you might expect, and at Cleo, like, I expected like a fully black audience, but it wasn't fully black. Majority black, though.
There's only one person.
Yeah, I mean, the scene loves her. Like, yeah, that's white, yeah. Black.
So that was a nice surprise.
Only one person you could go see and you won't see white people.
Who?
Dexter Dabbs.
Of course.
You know that for sure. You know that for a fact, don't you?
Unfortunately.
Mm. Unfortunately?
As in, not like that, but would I go see him again?
But you love him, though.
I love three songs.
That's enough.
For me, at a push. Salute to Dexter, though.
Drake is busting a gut right now behind the camera.
Drake. Drake's was in his bag, fam. You should have seen Drake's, bro. I can't lie to you, fam. Drake's didn't even look left or right. Drake's was so in the zone.
Like, yeah, I can imagine.
Like, Drake's was how I was.
Yeah, Drake's is the dancehall almanac.
Hashtag dancehall.
Yeah.
I've seen this guy do Gully Creep, bro.
Reggae.
Oh, 100% you're
right. Reggae, everything.
Catch him on a good day. Yeah.
Can't lie, anything. Anything with broken English, he's there for.
Wow.
Anything with broken English, reggae, anything. The way I was acting, like for 50, he was with like for Dexter.
Yeah.
I hear it.
I've never seen Daddy really lost so many lyrics like that in his life.
Yeah.
Listen, living his best life.
What'd you say?
Like the rest of us.
I'm trying to catch up to him.
Mm. Now I hear it, man. But yes. Inside joke. But yes, shout out to everybody watching and listening. Shout out to the Spotify crew, the SoundCloud crew, the Apple Podcast crew, the Amazon Music crew, Google Podcast crew, and every other crew out there. Very much appreciate it. We're going to get straight into the first topic. And unless you've been living under a rock in the UK, or for our non-UK listeners and viewers out there, the last couple of weeks have been very important for the UK scene, because we saw the return of the one and only J Hus, who has been very much quiet since his last album, Big Conspiracy, in 2020. And he released his first solo single in 3 years, basically, this past couple of weeks, called It's Crazy. And it shook the scene. You know, it split opinion for reasons that we will probably get into later. But yeah, it was a big, big moment for the scene. And as the dust settled, people started talking about how it's been performing, just in terms of like chart position and in terms of like numbers, because I think it dropped on a Wednesday. And I saw a tweet from a Twitter page called Represent London. And it basically said that, let me get it up, J Hus's new track, It's Crazy, failed to do 1 million views in a day. Do you think Hus should have kicked things off with an Afro swing type track, etc.? Now, J Hus, if you don't know, he's known for being kind of a pioneer for Afro swing, UK Afro beats, Afro bashment as well. And this song, It's Crazy, is very much a drill song. And
drill?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's kind of more like, not commercial drill, but it's not as drilly as like drill sort of thing. But it's got the drill vibe to it. So, yeah, I just wanted to open up a conversation about expectations for certain artists. Because I suppose for someone who like J Hus, who's like very much an acclaimed guy, he's one of the big three that we've got in the UK along with Dave and Stormzy, like his return is and will be a big deal. But I guess for some quarters of the scene, unless you're hitting a certain number right at the gate, it doesn't really matter what you're doing. So I guess I just wanted to open up a conversation about fan expectations and whether fans are expecting too much from artists, and whether artists are suffering under the pressure of that expectation. Because I saw this tweet and I just thought to myself, like, within a day he did nearly 1 million. He did like nearly 900,000. So it's like, it's not, I mean, for anybody, that's great numbers, especially within 24 hours. But I suppose because we have this idea of what he should be doing, or at least some of us have this idea of what he should be doing, and when he doesn't reach that, it's like, oh, he didn't do it sort of thing. So, yeah, I just kind of want to open up a conversation, really.
I mean, for you two, because you two are like massive J Hus fans, like, do you feel like the song itself reached your expectations and then the reaction to it?
To me, just to contextualize this, Hus musically is the greatest ever to me in the UK.
Ever?
He's top five to me already. Like, just musically.
See how he walks that back so quickly.
Yeah, he does that.
No, but like, because I don't want to speak out of turn without really thinking on it and just commit to saying he's the goal. But like, to me, I'm just talking about music, just not bars, not just rap, just everything encompassed. He's definitely top five to me. Top three, arguably. I can't lie. I can put in my head up a lot of people, just musicality. So when this song came out, I wouldn't say I was disappointed. It was just, there's certain things that's just always going to throw me for a loop. And starting the song off saying 666 and the devil.
He didn't do 666.
Whether people want to hear it or not, I'm sorry, it's going to throw me for it. I like, it, why is it, it's fed. I'm the same guy that never used to sing My Man's Verse in 21 Seconds. I'm the same guy. I worship the red is my best color. I'm the same guy that
that is much more explicit than what J Hus did, though.
What was his first opening bar for the song?
He said, "The devil in me, demon in me," right?
And he said 666.
Cool, but
did he say 666?
He didn't
say 666. I don't know if he said 666.
I'm sure I heard the numbers.
He said had six, but I let go of three.
Oh yeah, that's what he said. That's a crazy bar. That's actually
come on, man.
Okay, cool. The devil in me. It's enough.
What do you mean, bro?
Like, it's...
Stop acting like so scared, bro. No, like, the when he's referring to the devil, he's just referring to like the badness, which we all have, the darkness, which we all have. He's just using the word devil.
The devil in me, demon in me. And I completely agree with Peter.
Okay, maybe I'm tripping because I don't know why I thought...
No, but you're not the only person that reacted that way.
A lot of fans have reacted this way. And for extra context, I'm going to read out another tweet which kind of speaks about the kind of sales performance of the song by Opinionated UK. So the comeback single It's Crazy by J Hus ends the week at number 15 with 18,834 sales. It began the week at number 6 but drastically fell after the song was boycotted for what seemed to be satanic references slash worshipping. Not the best way to return, but at least it's a return. So that is suggesting that a lot of people are not happy with that, which to me is very, very interesting considering the nature of his music.
I was going to say
when he talks about juju, when he talks about bunsams, which if you don't know, are guns, when he talks about murder, when he talks about all this stuff, it's basically okay. But when he talks about the devil in me, the demon in me, which we all knew what that meant.
Yeah, that's a fact.
It's a problem.
I agree.
Sort of thing. So, and clearly, if that's the case, and it's affecting like the sales performance of this, then it goes to show that a lot of people are not happy.
Outside of that bit, do people like the song?
I was going to say
what's the social media?
I think it's mixed. I think it's very mixed. I think from what I've seen anyway, it's been very, very mixed. But I feel like, to Mo's point, a lot of people are finding it hard to negotiate those bars.
But to
and it's
me,
turning them off the song. So even if they like it, they can't get jiggy with it because.
But to me, it's bigger bars. than the bars. The first time I heard it, I was like, whoa. But like, is it not fair to say it's a meaty song? Like, don't mean you're going up against Hus.
Yeah, but do you feel that?
I think the song's meaty.
Okay,
like,
now we're getting.
I think the song's a meaty. Like, it's not a song that's. I don't think I've gone back to it. Being completely honest with you, like, I haven't. Like, it's not. I just don't think it's a good song, and I think it's more that than anything else, and I don't think people just want to accept Hus has come back with a bad song because of who Hus is.
Right.
Do you get what I'm saying? Because of Hus, it's no matter what he drops, we need to elevate it to something on another plateau. And I get it. When you've given us Common Sense and you've given us Big Conspiracy, you've laid the blueprint for like, you have not failed yet. We haven't seen Hus fail yet. So it's the first time he stumbles, everyone's going like...
In your opinion?
In my opinion. The first time he stumbles, the backlash is, oh, maybe he needs to... I don't think it was the bar. I just think all around it wasn't a great Hus song, in my opinion.
So what was what was your expectation in order for you to say that though?
Because we didn't know it was coming out, I generally didn't have no expectations.
I told you it was coming.
No, as in,
His sources.
Honestly,
Peter's industry, guys.
We need to give that.
Relax.
We need to talk about that because Peter gave us an exclusive and people didn't want to hear it. But he said he heard Hus is dropping
soon. Industry one. Okay.
And the industry, this guy here,
relax.
His connections
he's
are
in
clean.
The J Hus camp. He is 2K management.
So can
he is 2K management. Him and Mimi. Shout out Mimi.
Can you tell your connect, don't get offended by this because clearly you have someone next to Hus. But yeah, like, I didn't have no expectations. I generally didn't know what to expect because it's Hus. Like, it's Hus can do what he's got so many. It's like you said, he does bashment sometimes, he does afro sometimes, do you know what I mean? He picks so many different pockets. To me, Hus is the most varied musician we have in the UK.
Right.
He could do stuff Dave can't, he could do stuff Stormzy can't, but he could do what Dave can, he could do what Stormzy can. Do you get what I mean? But they can't do Hus. So I think when he came back with it, I listened to it, I like it, but would I say I'm gonna go back to it? No.
But what did you expect?
I expected, I'll be honest, in terms of as a song, or what did I expect from Hus?
Yeah, so
I expected to come back. I said, when I saw Hus come back, I said it's gonna be the best song in the last 3 years.
Wow.
Like, not like
that. Look at it, that's no, it, no, and no, that's
see,
what,
see,
that's
no,
why
no, no,
top...
Can I just say, but guys, I was exaggerating. Please don't stick it, I'm exaggerating.
Oh, go on.
When I heard the songs coming out,
right.
No, don't get me wrong, I expected a fucking banger. But that's your fault as a musician.
What do you mean?
You've given me the if I've never seen, if someone has scored 30 goals 3 seasons in a row, can I not go into that fourth season and say you're getting 25?
Bro, your expectations is none of Hus's business.
No, but
as an artist, and I'm not an artist, man, but as an artist, bro, all he does is make the art.
What's your expectation?
How you react to that is your business. That's not his, bro.
Yeah,
he has no control over how you receive his music.
Yeah, but
so if you then build him up to a place to where he probably may not even subscribe to you, but he's just doing his art. Why is that his problem?
No, not his. When I say his problem is I've put you on that pedestal. So maybe it's on me, but at the same time, you're fair as a fan to have expectations if you feel like a musician has not failed you yet. King's Disease,
yeah,
if I say,
cool.
if King's Disease 4 is, if Nas drops King's Disease 4 and it's an absolute shit.
But the tricky thing
do
with
I not,
the, yeah, but,
can we not go, yo,
Mo,
like,
Mo,
it's
Mo,
not the last
Mo,
three.
Mo. But Mo, the tricky thing with that is, yeah, when we have expectations as fans, yeah, we place the responsibility on the artist. We all do that, bro. And that's where it's not fair. And that's what I'm saying. I think that's where it's a bit tricky with the unrealistic expectations that as consumers we have for these artists, man. Because it means that that means that you might actually be describing a song that's actually pretty good as meaty because it doesn't meet your expectation.
No, but
we put them on a pedestal where they are not allowed to fail. And I've spent the last couple
still
weeks.
On that pedestal.
I've spent the last couple weeks arguing with people about that. People who have been basically been criticizing his work rate because he hasn't been releasing songs or albums like yearly or whatever. And it's just like, bro, these are your expectations. They're not his. He moves at his own time. He moves at his own pace. And when it comes to the actual song itself, obviously it's a matter of taste. If you don't like it, fair enough. But to have such high expectations of a guy, granted, he's giving you amazing stuff. But again, it feeds into the idea that because he continues to give you great stuff, everything he drops must be great.
No, but like,
therefore he's not allowed to fail.
No, he's allowed to. But my point is exactly that. He's allowed to fail, but he's still there for me. I expect Huss's next song to be a banger. Every song Huss drops, I'm going to expect to be a good song.
Can you not hope for it rather than expect it?
No, because
for me, expectation is demand.
No, because I expect Kendrick Lamar's album to bang, the next one he drops. I expect that. Because why? You've given me four.
That's a lot.
It's a very privileged position for fans to expect.
No, it's privileged as fuck. But like, if you've given me dope shit, I can go and be like, yeah, I hope, don't get me wrong, because no one knows the future. But at the same time, no, like, you're one of them ones.
Do you listen to singles before the album drops?
Depends.
Okay.
I wouldn't say I'm pressed. But like me, I think expectation, if you're an artist and you don't have expectations on you, you haven't done your job as an artist. When I say expectations, I'm not talking about people that criticize Huss for not dropping enough songs. I'm just talking about, I say expectation, the quality of what you're going to drop. If people expect your quality to be at an elite level, it's because you're an elite artist.
Okay.
So therefore, whether it's unfortunate, but that means you're a great artist. You'd rather have expectations as an artist than not have expectations.
Cool.
Right?
Cool. But then when they don't reach those expectations, you get commentary like, is he like, all the tweets I've mentioned.
Yeah, but they're idiots.
Ooh, okay.
As in, no lie, but like,
it's very clickbaity what they've done.
It's clickbaity. Right? We're just saying,
but at the same time, this is also how people are feeling.
Yeah, but we're hip hop heads. You've got expectations on our artist. If your rapper don't hit your expectations, it's not dropping you where you still look at him as wherever. Do you get what I'm saying? Before or after,
I mean,
you still rank him where you rank him, right? You don't. Do you look at Huss any differently because of this song?
No.
I don't, and I don't like it. Mm. But I still expect when Huss drops an album, I expect that album to be the best album of the year in the UK.
That's a lot, man. Bro, do you not see how much that is? Do you not see how heavy that is?
I give the same expectation. When Kendrick dropped, when I had that two years before that, when we done the predictions, I said Kendrick's going to drop album of the year. He dropped it 2 years later. To me, it was the album of the year.
Debatable.
To me, it was the album of the year. So like, there's certain rappers there's certain musicians I feel like, when Kanye was on that first 5 album run, you're telling me we couldn't say come graduation, amazing.
Yeah, but cool. Even if that's the case, and even if your opinion of someone doesn't change in the immediate aftermath of them doing something that isn't to your standard, if they then continue to do stuff that isn't what you expect, then your mood, your thoughts are going to start changing, right? If Kendrick now drops 5 bad albums, your opinion of him will probably change, right?
Definitely.
There you go. So it's a slippery slope when you have expectations of someone from the jump, because if they're not meeting exact specific expectations, then it becomes a problem. And then you get commentary around J Hus like, what's happening?
But we give expectations to every facet of everyone we watch. We give expectations to sports.
They don't make it right though.
Yeah, I'm just saying, but we do it. You've got expectations on your footballers. You've got expectations on your musicians.
I mean, I don't really expect from people anymore.
Fernando Torres in his prime, you didn't expect him to bang this a season.
I hoped he would.
Steven Gerrard in his prime,
Especially when it comes to music, I don't really expect from anybody anymore because everybody moves at their own schedule and everybody moves.
I'm not talking about expectations on release dates.
No, but I'm saying.
I'm talking about expectation on the music.
Yeah.
Cool. But again, artistically, everybody moves to the beat of their own drum, right?
True.
What you might think isn't the most musical might be very, very musical to them. J Hus, this single, clearly it was very much to me anyway, I interpret it as a kind of aggro, raggo, cruddy type song that he's kind of getting out of his system, and then we're going to get some of the more stuff that we're familiar with him on the album sort of thing. People didn't like it. People are making excuses for it with the references and stuff, but that is what it is. Everybody's sensibilities are different. But like I said, it's a slippery slope when you start to expect stuff of a high quality every time from artists.
I don't think it is, man. I think if an artist...
Of course it is.
I think if an artist gives me a certain level from the minute they've come into the scene, I can go into that. The next time you drop, I can go into it and go, yo, I expect
but
a good not, album.
What we're arguing is not that you can't.
What did you say?
We're not arguing that you can't have that. We're arguing, should you?
And I think you should. And I think the artist...
You think you should have expectations.
I think you should. And I think the artist should be... And it's going to sound crazy. The artist should be happy that there's an expectation on them. If I'm an artist, I'll rather have an expectation on me than not. Because if I don't have an expectation, people don't care.
Nah, that's not true. Nah, you're bugging.
That's
me.
Not true at all. Because Frank Ocean.
Do you have an expectation on Chingy's next album?
Chingy?
Yeah.
Why do you always go for the most extreme example?
Yes or no?
It does that, innit?
No, do you have an expectation?
Why are you using Chingy?
Okay, you're right. Let me take it back. Do you have an expectation on Machine Gun Kelly's next album?
I mean, it's the same shit as Chingy.
No, pick an artist that he actually likes.
Do you have an expectation? It fits my agenda. Do you have an expectation?
Nas is next album.
King Disease 4, do you have an expectation?
No.
Zero.
No. I don't have any expectation for Nas,
Dave's
Kendrick, Jay, Dave. I don't have expectations for them. I don't look at them and think, it needs to be this, it needs to have this.
Yeah,
it needs
man.
To,
no, I'm no, not no, saying no, the days no, are gone, bro. No, 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 them days
not,
are gone, no, man.
But I'm not giving a list of what I expect. It's just one thing I expect.
Well, for
a
it to be
a fucking
good.
Album.
Huh?
To be yes. dope. To be
bro,
dope.
That's, yes. a lot, that's a lot to ask.
That's not a lot to ask, bro.
Because a lot goes into your expectation,
bro. No, but you're my favorite artist.
No, but a lot goes into your expectation, bro. Your expectation is coming from a place of what they've already given you.
Yes.
So you're going to judge the music based on that.
No.
So if they don't give you close to what they've already given you, then you may not feel like it's good.
No, because you could give me, the reason why I know, because for example, Off Season with J. Cole.
Right.
That's nothing like anything he's given me.
Okay.
I like the shit out of it.
Okay, but that's an example of you liking it. I'm talking about an example of you not liking it.
Plus, you also had expectations for that.
What, Off Season?
Yeah,
I definitely had expectations for Off Season.
Yeah.
But I also had expectations for KOD. KOD being absolute trash. And I know we're getting off topic from Hus.
Mm.
But I had expectations for KOD. KOD was absolutely trash, in my opinion. But I don't look at Cole any differently.
Listen, I just
But
feel
you might if Off Season was trash.
I personally wouldn't. Personally. Just,
if but, Hus- that's but okay, but if let's just assume that you would. If KOD was trash to you and then Off Season was trash to you.
And For Your Eyes Only was trash.
And For Your Eyes Only was trash. That's three trash albums, right? Your opinion of J. Cole is going to change because of the expectations you put on him. And that's what I mean when I talk about a slippery slope. Because if they're not meeting your expectations every time, then your opinion of them is going to change. And that's going to be a thing.
I think when you're elite,
you're J. Cole's always, not elite, but.
What do you say?
J. Cole's not elite.
J. Cole's elite. Country. J. Cole's elite.
He's not an elite artist.
J. Cole's an elite artist.
No, he's not.
Okay. When you're an elite when you're an elite artist, I think it's expected. And I think it's fair. I generally do, because you've given me a precedent to follow. I'm not saying I want a blueprint of, I don't want Common Sense. I don't want Big Conspiracy. I want J. Hus.
Mm. I think you're conflating, and I'm trying to figure out the best way to articulate why I think you're conflating, because like I feel like you're with your expectations of an artist dropping an amazing album based on the fact that they've been amazing, it's not that you can't hope for them to continue to drop amazing music, but it's the weight of you expecting. Because again, for me, an expectation is like a demand, isn't it? So there's a lot of weight in that. Because if they don't meet that because of how you've built them up, all of a sudden they're not good. I think that's so like reductive to artistry, bro.
But then what's the first thing I said though? It doesn't take
case
away from
point.
Your art. It doesn't take, I don't think you're whack no, if you drop one bad album.
No, but you say that, bro. But if an artist gives you back-to-back-to-back albums of not meeting your expectation, yeah, your view of them, if they haven't got enough credit in the bank here, your view of them will change.
But that's music.
I'm talking about you.
But that's us.
No, I'm talking about you.
That's all. We had a conversation with Oshie. How many albums does it take
bro,
for you to
deflecting.
Check?
Stop deflecting, I'm talking about you.
No, but that's everyone.
Case
is everyone
point.
Muhammad?
But case in point, look at all the commentary around Kendrick last year. How no one really liked the album and it's a dent on his legacy. I saw so much commentary on Twitter about that. It's not good. You know, Kendrick had a bad one. His legacy is looking shaky. Da 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 da. That is what I'm talking about when it comes to the slippery slope. When you have such lofty heights for someone, And it can be a thing where you don't like the album. That's fine. You don't have to like the album. But for you to then fix your lips and say, oh, they're not as good anymore, or their legacy's this, or their legacy's that, that's the issue. And I feel like with J Hus, I was starting to see that with J Hus.
I started to see it from the minute you was getting in. And there's been a Hus dialogue before the Hus even dropped the album. I feel like people are just, for some reason now, just in a weird space with J Hus. I don't personally understand it. Like, oh, J Hus
is weird.
It's weird to me. Like,
I think... Sorry to cut you off. I think something that I didn't say as well is that I think when an artist gives us a lot of time as far as not releasing music, that's where things can get a bit techy in it, because you have way more time to then build them up even more so, because you think they're working on something crazy, which is why they haven't dropped. And then I guess that's where the expectation comes in. I still don't think it's fair though on the artists, man. Like, it's so much projection from us, bro. They don't really ask for it. They're just doing their own thing. They're just living their life, doing their own thing and that. And then we're here sitting constructing things in our mind of them dropping like the most amazing project. And when they drop a single that's probably not what we think it should be, all of a sudden they're
not great.
People criticize Huss's work rate knowing what he's been through. Been to jail, been stabbed, all that stuff. And they're still criticizing his work rate because he's taken 2 years or 3 years off.
Me personally, if I was an artist, I love the way Hus. I love when my rappers drop an album and disappear for 3 years. I love that. So I've got no issues with, but how can I put it? The rappers set expectations on themselves. If you're telling people you're the greatest ever in some of your bars, aren't you setting that precedent for you? Aren't you setting expectation already? If you're telling people I am better than everyone that's ever come out.
Not really, because they don't have any responsibility on how you choose to receive that. If I tell you that I'm the greatest to ever do it, bro, I don't really care how you receive that. If you then think because I'm the greatest, that means I'm dropping an album every year to prove that. That's your business. Yeah, that's not my business, fam.
I agree.
You feel me?
Because when I hear that, if Lil Wayne's telling me he's the best rapper alive, that doesn't mean I'm not computing that as like, okay, he needs to drop more to prove that. You know what I mean?
No, it's more about the quality. That's what I'm saying. To me, I don't ever care about how often you drop an album. I don't care. Like, you could drop it once. I like when my rappers drop once every 4 years. I don't want to oversaturate the market. Oh. But I'm saying, great word. I'm saying, but if you're saying I'm the greatest ever, I'm this, I'm that, bro, you set. And it depends on the rappers. When Lil Wayne said, a dead rapper says, I don't care. Mm. But if you're if I view you, just me personally, as an elite artist, I expect elite albums. And if you don't hit, you don't hit. Not everyone hits 100%. That's fine. You're still an elite. If Hus misses with this album, say he drops an absolute clanger, Hus is still in my top five musicians, dead or alive in the UK, ever. He might be the GOAT, and I'm not exaggerating when I'm talking about everything. Skepta can't make music like Hus, respectfully. Wretch can't make music like Hus, in my opinion. Kano can't make music like Hus. I'm talking music and everything. Like, Hus is, he could drop a clanger, but I'm going to the next album. Yeah, I expect you to come back with another a great album. I don't think that's far-fetched for me to say, yo, you're J Hus. I expect a great album. How is that unfair?
I just think it's a lot of pressure on the artist, man.
Yeah.
I just think it's a lot of pressure on the artist, that's all.
There should be, actually no, they shouldn't, that's unfair.
Do you feel me? They're just making
that. Ultimately, you might perceive an album as a failure or an artist as a failure because they haven't reached your expectations.
What do you mean?
Okay, so if J Hus drops his album tomorrow,
yeah,
and it's not what you deem it to be, and I'm not necessarily using you specifically, some people will probably say the album failed, whether it was on a musical standpoint, commercial standpoint, there will be some sign, if they don't like it, that this album was a failure, didn't work out, sort of thing. It's the commentary. Has he really failed?
No.
But people make it out and make it something bigger than what it is. Just because they don't like something. Just because of their subjective taste.
And that's fine, man. We're in the business of everyone's got an opinion in it. Everyone's got views on albums and that. And you can criticize as much as you want, man. And it's going to come from whatever place it's going to come from within you, innit? And that's cool, man. But damn. I don't know, man. I just feel like artists, if they've given us like, you know, some great times, they deserve grace, man. That's all, man. I just give them room to breathe, innit? It doesn't mean we can't judge accordingly. You know what I mean? But I don't know, man. We already put a lot on them as far as just how we react to their art and that, man. But then the expectation angle as well, man, on top of everything else, I just think it's a lot, bruv.
Yeah, ultimately, I don't want a conversation about any artist to, when they drop an album that you don't like to be, are they on the decline? Are they failing?
And sometimes that could be true. Sometimes they may be on the decline. That actually may be the case.
But I think it's too early though.
Yeah. It's probably too early around J Hus specifically, but I guess what I'm trying to say is that like sometimes it's for fair. A wider conversation, you can have that conversation, but not maybe so soon after a single. He hasn't even dropped the next album yet.
But Twitter discourse is always going to be wild in terms of when it comes to music. Like they're always going to talk shit, for lack of a better word.
Yeah.
True. But don't make it right, man.
Amen.
Don't make it right.
Amen.
So I'm the only one out of us that expects from my eyes.
I've lived my life expecting that, like certain quality of music from artists. But I think nowadays, bro, I try not to, man. I try not to expect a thing.
Can I ask you a question?
Talk to me.
Cleo Soul says, I'm dropping an album in 6 months' time.
Yeah.
You tell me you don't expect a good album.
I'll be excited for it. I'm not expecting a good album.
Come on, man.
No, I'll be hoping for a good album. There's a difference.
Right.
I'd be hoping. I always hope for my artists to drop good albums. But like, because I don't really listen to singles beforehand. Like, I can't, there's not much to expect from. And my brain's just going to do what it does as far as like imagining and fantasizing about what it's going to be. But there's not a, like an expectation of, oh, it's going to be amazing. I'm just like, ah, I hope it's dope. I just hope for the best for my artists that I love. So
yeah. I hear you. I can't, I've always lived.
No, you're not the only one. I have two, bro. Yeah, this is a new, this is a new thing for me. This is like the last few years where I'm like, ah, when I stopped listening to singles, yeah, I just stopped this expectation because singles can shape how you anticipate things, innit?
That's
you
know what
I mean.
Though.
So,
but it's also,
if, and especially if the single's banging. If the single's banging, oh man, expectations go through the roof.
Oh yeah, that's a fact.
You feel me?
That's a fact. So, but with, when I say expectations is also limited to a few people.
You reckon?
Yeah, man. I don't expect certain things from, in the UK, I think the only one I expect something from is Hus. I didn't expect anything from Stormzy's album, respectfully. I don't expect anything from Dave's album, even though I think, I don't expect, tell a lie, I expect something from Dave's album. Mm. Dave and Hus are maybe the only ones in the UK that I expect, like, there's an expectation, there's a benchmark. And the benchmark isn't so much your old albums, the benchmark is just good.
Mm.
And I expect you, it's unfair for me not to expect anything else.
Mm.
If you haven't failed yet, surely it's like,
again, expectations are fine. But if expectations mold how you speak on the album and your commentary on it in a kind of negative way,
I agree.
That's when it becomes an issue.
Mm. I agree.
So it's very much a fine line you've got to tread. It's very fine to have expectations, but what do you do when they're not met?
Mm. You move on.
Well, you might, but a lot of people don't. Yeah. Hence, the commentary around it's crazy.
Mm. It's unfair to artists.
Luckily, Hus clearly isn't the type of person that really cares.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Mm. Like he was doing push-ups on Instagram the other day. Like, you know what I mean? Like, he wasn't doing correct push-ups, but he was doing push-ups.
So, don't get me wrong, I still expect.
Bro, I'll show you the video. It was mad.
I still expect a good album from Hus for what it's worth. A very good album.
I'm very excited.
Yeah.
Because we don't know, we really don't know what we can expect.
Yeah.
We don't know.
Yeah.
A lot of Ismalay, and don't say militancy type chat.
I love that shit.
And all that stuff. Revolutionaries, you know, all
don't
that stuff.
Don't say militancy.
And I'm sure there'll be some bangers as well.
Yeah, facts.
I mean,
like, come on, man. What would you rather me say to you guys? I expect Birdman to drop a 10 out of 10 album.
Nah.
See?
I mean, that doesn't... Okay, fine.
But you listen to Lil Durk, so you could say that.
Did you have expectations for Lil Durk?
No.
Interesting.
And that's the thing that surprised me the most. Like, that's a perfect example. There's no expectations with the Durks of the world. There's no expectation with other people. There's only expectation... I've only expect really from maybe 5 or 6 rappers.
Mm.
Like, I expect Cole, I expect Kendrick. I don't expect nothing from Drake. Zero, zilch, nada.
Mm.
So it's got nothing to do with who you are, where you're at. It's just musically, if I look at you and I go, you have not failed me yet, I can look at it and go, okay, now I see what you're saying with expect and hope.
It's normal.
I get what you're saying.
Yeah,
now.
It's normal.
Because I was about to say, I expect, but at the same time, it's also the hope of like, you haven't failed me yet, don't fail me now.
Yeah, man.
But like, the reason why I say expect is because when Drake drops, I've gone to the point now where if it wasn't for this pod, I don't think I would go with, if Drake drops an album, I've gone past the point of running to the album now. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So there's no expectation with him.
Mm.
The minute I stop checking your release date, expectation is gone
because
I'm not going to it. Whereas with Cole's, the Kendricks, the Hus's, the, if I'm going to listen to your album the day it drops, it's because there's a level of expectation there. And a level of caring.
The majority of, in fact, I think all the greats have given us songs that some of us will deem below par, man. So from that alone, and albums. So from that alone, man, I've lost expectation time.
But it don't take away from the greatness. You're allowed to miss.
Yeah, of course not. But I'm just saying, though, that helps me with not expecting shit, man.
I hear you.
I guess your opinion and your reading of the situation, I guess, is more mature than other two would completely write off someone off one single.
Jay-Z gave us Kingdom Come. Who am I to write someone off, bro?
Kingdom Come had lost ones, though.
Don't give me lost. Shout out to Chris at myself, but like,
that's a great segue into the fun topic, but we'll get to that.
But like, you, do you know what I mean, though, innit? Like, I'm never right. I would have wrote Cole after For Your Eyes Only if I really thought like that.
You definitely could have.
And I could have wrote him off after KOD. And I hate KOD. You know what I'm saying? I'm not writing you off after one bad album. I'm just saying, when you drop one bad album, I expect the next one to be good. If you drop another bad album, probably the third one I expected. If I rate you as an artist, I'm always going to check you and I'm always going to listen to you. The only reason I don't go back to Drake is I've never thought Drake makes good albums. That's the difference.
Fair enough. Cool.
Well, shout out to Hus. Shout out to everybody who loved It's Crazy. Shout out to everybody who didn't love It's Crazy. And yeah.
You're still the GOAT.
Mo said that. But, you know.
No call signs.
Listen, if the next album is what it is, then...
You're call signing me. You're call signing me.
I'm getting closer to it. I'll get closer to it.
You got
to
call signing
me. So what were you trying to say? If the next album is what, fire?
If the next album is of the same... quality in the same ilk as the last two, then yeah, he's on that upper echelon of like great.
Yes.
UK.
Yeah, see, I'm happy you said that.
Artist.
That's cool. I can accept that because I was about to get at you, bro.
Why?
Because I thought you were gonna say, oh, he's the GOAT.
No.
Yeah, okay, cool. Right, cool. See, I like that. I can accept that. I'm happy with that.
All right, cool.
Yeah. I don't know if he can be the GOAT, to be honest with you. He'd have to be see what happens when all said and done.
Right, because he needs to battle Wiley on a fucking staircase.
I mean, I was thinking more Skepta, but okay.
Sorry. What's your problem?
All right.
I'll be able to see you.
We'll move on then.
Sorry, that was
shabby. Shit. Aggressive. No, much. Aggressive much. Anyway, we're going to move on to the next topic now. And...
Altered alert.
Disclaimer.
Altered alert.
This is an interesting...
Proud of yourself. That's every time now. Watch.
This is an interesting one, which was brought to, all of our attention by our...
resident old head alert,
our resident dreadlocked fellow. So I'm gonna let him take the reins over this one. P, take it away.
Man. Yeah, man. So I want to say early 2000s.
Set the scene.
Yeah, early 2000s.
When you're selling bean pies in Brooklyn.
Saying, what's today's mathematics, son? God.
7 is 14. Oh, man. 14. Sorry.
Maybe you can talk like that in the 90s as well.
Early 2000s. Some conversations were taking place between music executives / moguls known as Marion Suge Knight, Jay Prince, and Irvin Lorenzo Gotti.
Why do you remember their names?
I don't know.
To Lorenzo.
And the conversations that were happening were to put together a black-owned distribution label that would rival that of Warner, Sony, and all the other ones. Yemi
Universal.
Universal. The Yemi can help me out with the other ones.
It's the big three.
And so I wanted us to, I guess, take a walk into fantasy world and imagine what would have happened. What would our industry look like had this distribution label taken form?
Them three in particular?
Those three in particular.
Do you want me to be completely honest with you?
Talk to me.
It wouldn't have gone nowhere.
Why?
Because it's Jay Prince, Suge Knight, and Lorenzo Gotti. At the time...
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's set the scene a little bit more, the context.
It came very close. Sorry,
Yemi.
The context being that, as Peter said, moguls in this rap thing, Suge Knight, co-founder of Death Row Records, Jay Prince, co-founder of Rap-A-Lot Records, Irv Gotti, co-founder of Death Row Records.
Murder Inc.
Now, inside all of those labels, you have the likes of Snoop, Dre, Tupac, Ja Rule, who's on Rap-A-Lot, Ghetto Boy, Scarface. Yeah. Big names in rap history.
Facts.
Some of the greatest to ever do it.
Facts.
And they're pulling together their collective powers to bring about this black-owned distribution company that would then form into a union encompassing all of black music, not just rap, R&B, all of that kind of stuff in America. And if you're not familiar with what a union is, unions basically take care of like workers' rights when it comes to like fair wages, when it comes to like setting up their healthcare, their pension funds, that kind of stuff. Something that doesn't exist in rap, especially, and wider, hasn't existed in black music all the way throughout its history.
Does it exist in music, period?
Yeah, there are unions these days.
I didn't know
that. But we'll get into that. Very much a big deal what they were trying to do in the early 2000s. So I just wanted to paint that picture.
Yeah.
As you were saying, Mo.
Yeah.
No, I was just saying, if it was in the 90s, I think it would have been very different just because of where the artists were in that time. I don't know if Suge Knight had the power in the 2000s.
He did.
Did he?
Because he had just come out of prison after Tupac had died.
Did Suge Knight have
He still had like, I heard he still had like, about 200 M's. It could have run.
Oh, for real?
Yeah.
And apparently they were willing to put between them, no, I don't know, amongst them, like 30 mil each into this.
Mm. Okay, cool. The reason why I said no, just me mainly, is because of the pulling power that Suge had at that point.
You feel like Suge was the problem?
I feel like Suge Knight got respectfully should never run a label. There's not two ways about it. Suge Knight used to give people two options.
Mm.
Either you get punched up or people are about to piss and you're going to drink the bowl.
Mm.
Suge Knight had no reason.
Allegedly?
Mm. Allegedly. This was Corrupt that said it on Breakfast Club.
Numerous sources have said that.
Yeah. Oh boy, not so allegedly then.
But like, to me it's more Suge Knight than it was. If it was any other three people, like let's just say you said Hov, Gotti, and someone else, then the context of the conversation changes.
Mm.
And do we need it? Yes, we do. But I feel like anything Suge Knight touches to me is flammable.
Yeah, but I think, I understand what you're saying about Suge, innit? Suge is Suge, innit? But like, I think the difference would have been that he's got partners that have just the amount of power as him. Like, he was running Death Row by himself. Like, he muscled out Dr. Dre. He jacked that label from him and that. Do you know what I mean? And then he was like the head sort of thing. So he had so much like elbow room to do what he wanted to do with that label. We could run that shit like he wanted to run it, and he did.
You don't forget.
Whereas with the distribution thing, like, bro, he's got like equal partners that have just as much say as him.
But you don't forget.
And it's not a label, like it's a distribution that's completely different. They're like a subsidiary, like a fucking a Def Jam. It's very different, isn't it? So I don't feel like, yeah, cool, he still could have been acting like he was acting, but I don't know. I just feel like it would have been harder for him because of the people he was in partnership with.
I just feel like in this side, let me go.
I just think it's very interesting. As going into the mechanics of it a little bit, the idea of a black-owned distribution company, because ultimately, a lot of distribution companies in the present day work with record labels, or let's say an artist is signed to a record label, but they might not necessarily have their distribution done by the record label. They might go to another distribution company that might be in the record label. So let's say like The Orchard, they work with Universal, and they're very much a distribution company as well. So they work within that umbrella.
Mm.
So it would have been very interesting to see how that worked, because it's not a traditional label.
Mm.
It's not like artists are signing with the label and the label is taking care of every aspect of it. It's mainly just a distribution. So I think in some aspect, they probably would have had to work with labels anyway, like the Universals, the Sonys, the Warners. I think so. They would have. I feel like there would have had to have been some kind of communication or some kind of like action with each other.
Did they have it monopolized?
For the reasons I've just said, like a lot of distribution companies work either with the labels or work under the umbrella of one.
Mm.
So unless you're an independent artist, it could be a thing where you work with a distribution. But at the time, there weren't that many.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So I don't think it's a thing where they could have probably maybe enticed people out of record label contracts, which is another beast entirely, to solely become independent and do the distribution thing. I feel like the way the music industry was set up back then, I feel like it would have been impossible for them to not work with the labels in one way, shape, or form.
Monopolized on another level.
Yeah, because the climate wasn't really encouraging really like independence. I mean, we saw what happened with Prince and stuff, and even that was a madness for him. So I feel like just mechanically, I don't know how it would have been able to survive without working with the labels, you know?
But the Prince situation is a bit different, isn't it? Because that's pop. And Prince is like, he's different. But in hip hop, I think it could have run, you know? I think it definitely could have run. I think it could have set a precedent for what was to come, because like that Rockefeller, they were, even though they were under the umbrella of Def Jam, like a label like that, I feel like could have been enticed to being distributed by whatever their corporation would have been. I think quite easily. They would be of the mentality of, independent thing and maybe a larger slice of the pie.
But in that example, Rockefeller still reports to Universal. So the black distribution company would have to work with Universal.
Unless Rockefeller didn't renew with Universal and decided that they were going to go with this new
company. Oh yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's what I'm more so saying.
Okay, well, I mean, yeah. In that scenario, yeah, cool.
Yeah.
But if it's a thing where they're very much tied into their deal with Def Jam and Universal, and they then want to do this, they either would have to wait until their deal is done, or if they wanted to do it anyway and maybe strong arm themselves out of the situation that they're in, maybe they do it that way.
Listen, but again, man, Suge was helping strong arm a lot of people out of their contracts. Oh, man, Joe Desi, Mary J. Blige. He had experience in doing I'll that, man. So I don't think it would have been difficult.
I think Compton Fraser.
But then he just would have made a lot of enemies. And what happened?
He can't have any more enemies than he already had.
But what happened to him?
That's what the problem was. That's why it wouldn't have worked. What you just said now. You think, all realistically, let's just say Rockefeller. You think Hov will leave to go stand with Suge? In all honesty.
It's not just Suge though.
But he, regardless, Suge is now your boss.
It's Jay regardless, Prince as well. And
Jay Prince.
I've got
you. You think Hov is in respect? Like, there's no way. There's no way, like, I could see.
And to that point, I watched a video about this on YouTube. I'll put the link in the description of this episode. And there was a comment on the video that said, as great as this idea is, there's no way Suge and Jay Prince could pull this off without extorting, strong-arming, and or robbing the artists. Feds would have come knocking before long anyway. So I guess it's a case of their reputations kind of preceding them. Mm. And their reputations meaning that maybe other people were maybe too scared to really get into bed with these people. Mm. Or what happened and what ended up happening would have happened anyway, sort of thing. So it's very hard to imagine how it would have got off the ground to Mo's point with those guys in particular.
Okay. All right, cool. So let's say it did.
Yeah.
Let's say it actually like was a known distribution label now and they were...
And Union.
Yeah. How do we think, if like our artists, our most prominent artists started like going independent, creating their own labels and then being distributed via them, how do we think hip hop would look? Because then by doing that, essentially you're the white man that's like kind of been within the... Do you know what I mean? They're not so much in it.
Inverted then, commas, white
this
man.
This is where it gets techie. I don't think they care. I don't think they're looking at... It's easy to sell us the black dream and be like, oh yeah, all for one, one for all. I think the minute the money comes in, I genuinely think it will just... Whatever's popping at the time, it's a money game. I genuinely feel it's a money game. So I think if whatever's going on now, let's just say they were running today.
Yeah.
And Suge was outside, Prince was outside, and Irv Gotti was still relevant. Mm. And these guys were just doing whatever they need to do. And Lil Durk was popping, the babies were popping, all of these guys were all popping. And all of them were under the umbrella, the same music is going on today.
I think...
Okay, let me ask a bit. What I was trying to get with my question was just...
Well, let me answer the question first. It changes the game. Mm. It makes independence and autonomy in your fingertips. Like you're able to, as you say, create a record label, get it distributed through this company, and you keep all of the money within your community. The white suits and the labels would have been very, very shook because they then don't get a piece of that pie.
That's a fact.
And you essentially do have a rival for all of what you're doing in everything that all the artists and the distribution company is doing. Mm. And to the point of the union, completely revolutionary. Mm. Like, you think of people like Biz Markie and Black Rob and DMX, who sadly passed away under very bad circumstances. That probably doesn't happen if the union happens. Healthcare is guaranteed, a pension's guaranteed. You know what I mean? Even if you haven't made a hit record for 10 years, you're still eating off what you were doing 10 years ago, sort of thing. So everybody is better financially, health-wise, mentally probably. The scene is completely different from what we see it as now.
What if this happened?
For the better as well.
If this happened.
Yeah. 100%.
Didn't Suge rob his own artists?
What do you mean?
On a slash, where I was watching a YouTube video and he's like, they weren't getting all the money they should have been getting. And I remember Snoop said it once. Mm. So if he was doing it to his artists, why won't he do it as a record?
Yeah, but that was probably more so in the contract that these artists may or may not have read or signed anyway. So it may not have been that he was robbing them. It may just be that it wasn't the best contract or the contract was in favor of the record label. Which is often the
case.
Yeah, because like even Pac, man, like it's sad. I've heard mad stories that like he didn't own a thing, bro. Yeah. It was all Suge Knight. It was all Death Row that owned that shit. So yeah, it was just case.
But Suge can't do that for everybody. In this fantasy where it's going well and a lot of different artists, and this is not just hip hop, it's across black music. He can't do that to everybody. He'd have to be, well, I'd like to think he'd be a lot more professional in the way he handles his business. He can't strong arm everybody.
Suge Knight.
I don't think he'd be able to, man.
He can't strong arm
everybody. He couldn't strong arm someone like a Master P.
Facts.
Do you know what I mean? And there'll be numerous like people like that that will be very business savvy that won't really allow for that.
And then would he get, for lack of a word, would they get in bed with each other?
Yeah.
Yeah, he can't strong arm everybody. Yeah. I think he might try and strong arm some people, but if you've got hundreds of thousands of artists distributing for your company, you can't fuck all of them over.
Yeah, but then if you're fucking over 100 of them, your whole narrative of doing this for us is now proven false.
And then it goes back to status quo, probably.
True.
So, listen, I'm not ruling out the idea that Suge Knight will Suge Knight the whole thing, but it will at least, along the way, completely change the game.
Yeah. Mm. I think we need
it. And on the union perspective, even if an artist wants, let's say he does want to do the distribution thing, he or she can still benefit off the union. They can have a union rep come into the negotiating table with labels. They can let them know what they're signing. That can prevent a lot of exploitation. That can prevent 360 deals, all that kind of stuff. So generally, it educates us a lot more on what we're doing, how we're doing it, and how we're making money off it as well. So I think there's good sides to all of it as well.
Yeah, and another example of us controlling our own destiny as well, and controlling what's ours, our art, because... And we've alluded to it on there like enough times, but we don't
flat out said.
Okay, we've said it. Shit, we've said it. It ain't really ours anymore, man.
Whose is it?
The white man.
Hey man,
I brought an AD over here.
Brother, man.
All right, so let me put on my conspiracy hat. Yeah,
let's put it on.
And what if I said to you, man, that like, so these men were very close to pulling this off, yeah. And then when these the Universals and the Sonys and the Warners started kind of getting a whiff of this year.
How though? Because there's a rumor going around.
Don't do that.
Because story time, people.
Hold on, let me finish. Before you intervene. Wait, hold on, let me finish. So what if I said to you, man, that like to put a stop to this year, they were gonna start targeting these three individuals, and slowly but surely each one would start getting fed cases. So you start off with Irv Gotti, with like whatever was happening with his affiliations with particular drug lords or whatever. And then you had Suge Knight, who was, you know, all sorts of legal troubles were finding
him. He physically killed someone.
This was way before that.
That was later.
And then you had Jay Prince that was also being investigated. So what if I said to you that like was a conspiracy was taking place to ensure that this not get off the ground?
God.
What would you man say?
Can I answer that?
Talk to me.
In the nicest way possible.
Yeah.
At least two of them.
Right.
For lack of a better word, allegedly, are fucking criminals, bro.
Allegedly.
Like, Jay Prince does an Insta video every other month warning people. Suge Knight killed someone and is in jail. The only one that I might believe...
but that's later though, man.
Right, cool, but we're acting like we don't... It's not out of the ordinary for Suge Knight to have a case. It's not, bro. What Suge Knight was on, everyone knew he was on. This guy used to wear a big red suit at 6'8", 350 pounds. Everyone knew he was on. The only reason why I might believe this conspiracy is because of the last guy you said. Irv Gotti.
But he had actual links to my man, didn't he?
Irv Gotti?
Yeah.
Yeah, to what, Jimmy?
No, Supreme.
Supreme, sorry. I was going to say Jimmy Hendrix.
Listen, I'm not going to rule it out because it was still the era where you could very much get away with that shit. I'm kind of conflicted on it because I'm trying to place it in its time, and I'm not too clued up on, like, you know, either of their criminal record leading up to that point. So I can't really say with chest like it was a coincidence, it was a conspiracy, but I also can't say it wasn't, sort of thing. So it's a genuine I don't know.
But what did you hear?
It is very telling though. I haven't heard anything. All I can see is that after when someone snitched, we'll get into that. When someone snitched, fed cases started.
But we don't know if that's true. We don't know.
Do you want to expand to the audience?
Ah, cool. Let me expand. So, Dame Dash of Rockefeller Records. There's been a lot of speculation about his involvement in this distribution company / union. Some people like to think that he was very involved, and some people think that he wasn't involved at all. And he did an interview on Sway, right? Sway in the Morning, where he essentially said that Jay-Z told Leo Cohen about the union / distribution company.
Allegedly,
Jay-Z was the one that let the cat out of the bag, and then that just set the domino effect for it to not happen. I'm not saying I believe it. I'm just saying, if it's true, We're looking at Jay-Z very funny in this.
I don't believe it.
Yeah, I know.
I don't believe anything Dave Dash has thought.
And I'm a conspiracy. I'm a conspiracy theorist, isn't it?
But oh, you're no, sure you are.
They're just certain conspiracies.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not all of them.
Nah, not all.
We know which ones. Okay. We know which ones we believe.
Very interesting.
Yeah, but that's not even a conspiracy.
That's not even a conspiracy. Why are we here?
Death and destruction of our people.
Come on now. Persecution.
Pillaged and fucking
persecution.
Persecuted.
Come on now. I'm just telling you.
How did we get here?
They've got a lot of peas. Persecuted. What else do they do?
I don't know.
Persecution. Privilege.
They've got privilege. They persecute my people.
Oh,
and what's the last one you said?
Pillage.
And they pillage my people.
Okay, we're getting off track. Yeah. But yeah, I mean,
and that's what they want you to do. Sorry.
I'm coming to. I'll probably remember.
that's a good one.
But yeah, it is very funny, but not in a funny way that. It was literally case after case after case as soon as the cat was out the bag. Yeah. So if anybody out there who is a conspiracy theorist is trying to make 2 and 2 69, fair, I get it. But at the same time, I can't get over what Mo was saying about their reputations and all that as well. Even if it came to be fair, Suge Knight kind of had that reputation anyway going into that. Mm. Even if it didn't translate to legal troubles. So I feel like with him on board, while it would have done well, I'm not sure how long it would have lasted with him under the helm.
Right.
Or maybe even Jay Prince or Irv Gotti, because they all kind of had their moments in the sun, and now they're not as relevant anymore, sort of thing. Maybe it would have gone to New Blood, who knows? But I just know that it represented a great opportunity. But there is a union. There is a rap union now. It's called the Hip Hop Alliance. It was founded by Chuck D, Dougie Fresh, and Curtis Blow.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
So they're essentially
we'll play you basketball.
He was the nicest at the time though.
We'll play you basketball.
He was the nicest at the time.
Sorry, by the way. Sorry.
So that launched this year, and it's non-profit, and you can donate to it. And they're doing the same thing. They're trying to safeguard rappers' interests and all that stuff as well. And in the wider music sphere, there's this union called SAG-AFTRA, which is essentially an alliance of the Screen Actors Guild, which is like film and entertainment, and AFTRA, which is kind of like a new union for like musicians. A lot of people don't know about it, and a lot of people don't know how to sign up, but it does exist. Wow. So there are unions out there who are trying to right the wrongs of history.
Fair dues.
It's just, I guess it's unfortunate that the version that Suge Knight and Jay Prince and Irv Gotti were trying to present to us didn't get off the ground for whatever reason.
In the nicest way possible.
And you keep saying that.
You might know how I feel about us. Like, I'm always for it. I'm not disappointed they didn't go through. Mm. I'm genuinely not. I don't trust them through. Like, in the nicest way possible. It would have been two crooks and an idiot running that league.
The white man has done that to you.
No, but no, don't get me wrong. I'm not. It's generally just.
Suge Knight is definitely
which robbery do you prefer? That's what it is. Which one do you prefer? It's two criminals and an idiot.
Remember what Suge Knight said to Vanilla Ice?
Bro, he used to punch people up or make 15 man piss in a bucket and make someone drink it. He will give them two options. If you're getting punched up or you're drinking his piss and you want him to run a league.
It's an illusion. Come on, bro. Man. The white man wants you to think that.
What about Suge Knight?
Do you believe that?
I believe everything I read about
Suge Knight. Do you believe that?
Do I believe what?
Do you believe what you just said? Do you believe what you just said?
So Yemi, I wish I was with you and with the unfortunately and all of that. I'm glad that this
But it's more so what it represents, not the people who are spearheading it. Because ultimately, even if you don't like someone, you can really fuck with what they're doing if it's for the greater good.
Yeah.
Like, I don't necessarily fuck with Suge Knight as a person, but I can recognize that that is some GOAT shit that he wanted to do.
Yeah. I just doubt the intention.
Yeah.
Did you donate to Curtis Bowles Foundation?
I haven't yet.
Okay.
Mm. I found out about it the other day, but you know.
Fair dues.
I might.
I mean, for the records, I don't think it would have gone very far. I think like you, man, are saying, I think the personalities at some point would have clashed and it would have become an issue, innit?
1 million.
That would have been a big issue as well.
I think there would have been pending legal situations that would have eventually caused things to become
it's a bigger conversation, because say if something happened to them three, now what happens to the artists?
I'm sure someone else would take it over.
Yeah, but then who? Because then now what if say if all jokes aside, like just say a guy we've never heard of strong arms everyone and buys the company because the three people are in jail.
Mm-mm.
And then it's the next guy that owns the Houston Rockets.
Mm.
but right. he's in charge of 1,000 black musicians.
So you'd rather, it's more so the devil you know.
Yeah. And don't get me wrong, I would love for it to be our people, but it can't be any one of our people.
Why?
Because the ramifications of what can happen might be worse. If these three go jail and then a rich billionaire buys the company because legally there is no one there. So the courts can decide. Listen,
sometimes you got to run that risk. Sometimes you got to destroy the status quo and run that risk, man.
That's a fact.
Would you prefer like the Warners of the world continue doing what they're doing?
No, but it's also art. It's also, I can see where we're at now.
I get what you're trying to say.
Do you run?
What you're trying to say. It's kind of like, ultimately, anyone in that position runs the risk of getting very greedy and power hungry and doing stuff that doesn't really benefit the whole entire reason that we're doing this sort of thing. That can happen on both sides. I mean, we've seen it historically with labels. So I get you, but I would have liked to have at least seen it.
On the flip side, bro, like as an independent artist, you don't have to go via the distribution label.
That's a fact.
So you can completely avoid that. And we need to wrap up, but like, yeah, you can completely avoid that.
Give me any other three, I'll take it. Mm. Name any other, give me Diddy, Hov and someone else. What do they have? They had two criminals and an idiot. So give me Diddy, Hov and who's an idiot? Make of
an idiot?
Yeah.
I mean, Jermaine Dupri.
Yeah, there you go. Give me Hov.
Respectfully.
Give me Hov, Diddy, Jermaine Dupri. I will live with that. Mm. It's just them three is, I'll tell you, it's two demons, bro.
It's a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, man. Like, I didn't want to talk, like, Jay Prince. Look what Jay, you could edit this out allegedly, but like, look at Jay Prince doing, he's sending videos to Offset. His cousin just died. Like,
we've got 5 minutes. Man.
No, we've got five minutes. I refuse. I'm so glad that you didn't get off the ground.
You're paying for extra time.
All right, cool. That's not even okay.
No, I'm saying you're paying for extra time, innit?
No, I'm just saying, I'm very glad you didn't get off the ground, respectfully. I'm sorry. I can't even hide that, man.
Fair enough. But, you know, I love the idea. And listen, everything happens for a reason. It didn't happen for a reason. Maybe the Hip Hop Alliance can pick up where it left off and actually affect and generate real change for the hip hop game, but for black music generally. So salute to them and salute to all the unions out there representing workers, musicians, everybody in all walks of life, trying to get their slice of the pie. All right, we're gonna wrap up now with the fun topic. And after speaking about J Hus's comeback single, It's Crazy, we wanted to take a deep dive into some of our favorite comeback singles from years past, generations gone by. And by comeback, I set a criteria of if an artist has been away and not released any solo material for 2 to 3 years, and then they drop a single, that's their comeback single. So we're going to take it in turns to list our favorite comeback singles from some of our fave artists. Mohammed.
So I had two, but I can't remember the second one, so I'm going to go with one. And the reason why I remember this is because I feel like he was gone for about 2.5 years, 3 years. And then when he came back with this song, it set the precedent for his album. Do you remember when The Game dropped Red Nation?
Did he drop that first?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
So he dropped Red Nation.
Ooh,
and then I was like,
with Lil Wayne?
Yeah.
Oy,
so yeah. And do you remember it was a period where he disappeared for a while?
Banger.
The Game went quiet for a little while and then he dropped Red Nation. I went, blood the fuck up. If it's a gamble, motherfucker. What?
Banger.
So yeah, I'm going Red Nation. I'm going Red Nation, The Game. For a little curveball idea for you lot.
No, that's dope. Is that one?
Yeah.
I've got a few. I've got 5.
Oh, there we go. Talk to me. Nice, yeah,
I've got 6 actually.
Bro, boy.
So it's funny you spoke. It's funny because I got into the rabbit hole. It's funny you mentioned Kingdom Come earlier because I've actually got Show Me What You Got.
Show me what you got, Lil.
I love that song. Yeah, I love that song. Shit, appalling album, but that song, it just felt like a comeback. It felt like I'm back. That's what it felt like. The video was dope as well. He's playing poker with that girl.
So show me what you got, pretty lady. Show me what you got, Charlie.
That was dope. Dr. Dre, Still Dre.
I was thinking that as well.
I mean,
classic,
an immortal classic song. Not much needs to be said about that. Gangstar, Mass Appeal. So between Daily Operation and Hard to Earn, they didn't drop anything, and then the first single for Hard to Earn was Mass Appeal, again another classic hip hop song. Mobb Deep, Quiet Storm. Got that as well. I think that was in between Hell on Earth and Murder Music, right? And it was the first single from Murder Music. So yeah, come on. Rest in peace, Prodigy. And then on the UK side, I got Sirens by Dizzy Rascal. Always loved that song and always loved the video of him getting chased by like what seemed like the Queen's Guardsman. It was kind of weird, but good video nonetheless. And Skepta, That's Not Me. I mean, not much else needs to be said about that. Not much else. Classic moment.
I've got Still Dre by Dr. Dre as well. I've got the, for Kanye, For My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. I couldn't pick one single. So I've just chosen the Good Fridays as part of the rollout. And I feel like he'd taken a break and he was coming off the back of the whole Taylor Swift controversy. So yeah, I just liked everything he dropped leading up to that point. I've got Kano when he dropped Trouble, and Class of Deja when he dropped Hoodies All Summer as
good
well.
Good shout.
And that's all I've got.
Good shout.
Yeah, man.
Glad we had a mix of US and UK as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very, very, very good. All right. Well, quick and easy.
Yeah, man.
Shout out to all the comeback singles out there. Indeed. I wanted to have Mama Said Knock You Out, but it wasn't a comeback single. Even though you said don't call it a comeback. I've been here
don't call it a comeback.
I've been there for years.
Facts.
Red Nation came straight to my head when you brought this topic, man.
Explosion.
Yeah, guys, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Feeling love last time to exploding this time.
I was going
to
say
disgusting. I ain't really got any shout-outs, man. That's Cleo Soul for an amazing show.
I was going to say, once you've seen Cleo Soul, now the shout-out stop?
Probably, yeah, man.
Oh, wow. That's a bit deep.
He'd be your biggest fan sometimes.
Do you know what it is? I feel like, yeah, man, I've come to that point where I can, now stop.
No, you got to keep it consistent, man. You've done it now.
I've been shouting out for 3 years. That's consistent enough.
Keep it up, man.
Fam.
Evolutionary moves by Peter right here.
It's like God is good all the time. We ain't stopped it.
That's different. That's the Most High. But yeah, man, I feel like maybe it's come to that point where,
we move.
Yeah, man. But it's always a shout out to it, but I just don't need to verbally say it all the time.
Say no more.
Fair enough.
But yeah, man, always big up Cleo for an amazing show.
I want to shout out Dave and Central C. They dropped a single called Sprinter, which is, I like it anyway. So salute to Santan and Cinch. Obviously, shout out everybody that's been listening and watching as well. Appreciate you.
Salute to you all.
Well, any shout outs?
No.
Oh, I want to shout out Baby Keem and Kendrick Lamar as well. Your run continues. The Hillbillies is dope. I'm messy, girl. Pass off to name. Do you name ours girl or something?
Name ours girl, like
Yeah,
I ain't got no shout outs, man. I never really do, to be honest with you.
True.
I never really do.
Fair enough. And obviously, shout out Drake's as well, as always.
My brother.
Big up yourself, my guy.
All day.
But yeah, that'll do it for 92, episode 92 of the Rhymes Like Dimes podcast. If you want to get in touch with us, we are on at Rhymes Dimes Pod on Twitter, TikTok, and Instagram. You can get at us for topic suggestions or just to share some thoughts, rhymeslikedimespodcast@gmail.com. If you're watching on YouTube, follow us. Like, share, subscribe, hit the bell so you're notified whenever we drop episodes, album reviews, segments, all that good stuff. And continue to spread the good message about your boys. We'd very much appreciate it. But until next time, take care, stay safe, stay blessed,
stay black,
and peace.
Bang, bang, bang.
Peace to the gods on the earth.